Hi everyone, it's Brad Shores with Tropical Shores Steel Drum Lessons. We're live at 5 Central Time. And first I want to tell you that we have a couple technical things going on with our sound. There's a couple pops going on. We have so much going on here that we're never sure which pop is coming from where. And we just want to welcome you here tonight. The tune tonight is going to be Rock the Boat, the Hughes Corporation. I want to say 1973. And it's a fairly complicated rhythmic song, but if you know the song, that really helps a lot. So I would encourage you, if you don't know it, if you're, let's say, I don't know, younger, if you are one of those people, maybe YouTube it and listen to it. I don't think it's in the same key as what I have written out, but you get a really good idea of how the song goes, and that rhythm is very easy to assimilate. So before I go on any further, I hope you're not hearing those pops very loud, sorry. I have a special guest with us this evening, and she's all the way from North Carolina. It's my daughter, Jaimie. She's with us via Zoom. And say hello to everybody, Jaimie.
Hi, everyone.
Good to have you here. She's going to tag team with me, probably tell some stories that shouldn't be told, but that happens when you get a family situation. Tonight, we're going to go over some things about the song, and she's going to chime in and help out a little bit. First off, I wanted to let you know that this song is in the key of F, and the reason I know that is because it has one flat. One flat is the key of F, and a lot of the chords that are used in here are the B flat chord, and you can see it on the theory sheet that's being shown. Well, first, let's go to the scale. You can see the scale is F, G, A, B flat, C, D, E, F. And on the second line of the theory, you get some of the chords that are involved. The first one being the B flat chord, then the F chord, then the C chord. I want to get into that in just a minute, but the very first chord is the B flat inversion. And Jaimie, could you go over what the first inversion involves? What does that mean, first inversion?
So when you play a chord, normally you have the root or the tonic on the bottom. So normally if we were going to play a B flat chord, we'd play B flat on the bottom and then D and F above it. But to make different voicings, to make the music sound more rich and full, we sometimes invert the chords. So this time the D note that would have been third in the chord, the middle note of the chord will be on the bottom. So the inversion is then D, F, and then B flat being the tonic goes on the top. It's just a different way to voice the chord so the music sounds rich and full.
Yeah, so if you have those three notes, the B flat, D, and F, to summarize, if you have B flat, D, and F, I made the first inversion, I made the B flat go on top. I inverted it, and the second inversion that we don't have on there would be the F would be on bottom. You just stack them differently. And what does all that do? I'm not sure, but that's just the way it's written out for us. You can see some of the other chords are on there, G minor. If you have a small M next to the big letter G, minor means it's a minor chord, means the middle note of that note is flatted. And so we'll go over that more in a second. The one I wanted to draw your attention to, two of them, it's major 13. It's the last line of the theory sheet. It's a G9. Now that one's a complicated note or a complicated chord. But if you do the first note of that, you can see it's spelled G, B, D, F, A. You can see that. Well, that's a lot of notes. And I just had a gentleman from Arizona ask me, what in the world do we do? How can we play all those notes with just two mouths? Well, unless you're Superman, or unless you're Jim Taylor, I told him, you have to choose, and you have to arpeggiate, as Jaimie did. I did G, B, D, F, and then A. Now that chord, I noticed on the music that it went by very quickly, so I wouldn't worry too much about it. I just wanted you to know what it was and why it was there, because it is in the song. The other thing that's in this song is the A flat sus. And I remember this gentleman asked me, so what are you talking about sus? What does that mean? What this means is that there is one note in that chord that is suspended, meaning it's raised higher than it should be. It should be the note down here, but it's raised up, it's suspended. And the chord is the A flat sus. Now an A flat chord is A flat, C, E flat, and F. So what they did was they took the C and they made it a D flat. And then when you resolve it, it comes back down. But it's a momentary or a very temporary thing that sus chord usually is. But I want you to know why those were there. And before I forget, I want to go over to the board. But first, we need to hear from Bobble Brad. What has Bobble Brad got on his plate today? He has the word enharmonic. Now, we talked about it last week. It got Bobble Brad, it took him by surprise. So, last week the word that it was form, if you remember. And this week it's enharmonic. So, I'm going to go over to the whiteboard. And the whiteboard is going to explain, I hope it's going to explain enharmonic. Enharmonic means that one note can be called two different things. For instance, this is C on the keyboard. C, this is D on the keyboard. Well, if I go up to that note, I'm going up to C sharp. Sharps go up, flats go down. So C sharp and D flat are the same note. C sharp, D flat. Now I'm going to go to D. D sharp, E flat. You go over here and you go, well, there's nothing in between here. There is no E sharp and there is no F flat. There is, but we're not here to talk about that. That just takes too long to explain. Right, Jaimie? That's a long one, right? So
that's the trick one, yep.
That's a tricky one. And you have the same situation over here on B. There is a B sharp, which is C, and there is a C flat, which is B. But there is no black note between those two areas. So what I did, I'm going to go back to the pan cam for just a second. I hope you can see this, but I wrote C sharp and D flat on my pan. So I have a C sharp and a D flat. I wrote them both. Normally I put C sharp on there. You can maybe see on regularly I put C sharp here just because you hardly ever see D flat. And A flat over here, I also see that as G sharp. If you like to put those notes in your pan like that, I would encourage you to do that. I don't think it's necessary to have one or the other. You can have your choice or you can have them both. But I also have seen a lot of people on their C put B sharp, and I don't think that's necessary. That's, you hardly ever see a B sharp. In fact, I've never played music that has a B sharp. Jaimie, have you ever played a B sharp before?
Not that I can think of.
It would have been a memorable event for both of us. So, but that's
right.
That's Bobble Brad's word of the day, enharmonic. And because people, I've had people say, "Well, I don't have a C sharp or a D flat on my pan." Oh no, well you do. You just don't. You're maybe calling it something different.
And you can Google a list of those. You can look up, you know, enharmonic names or pitches on the internet, so that if you're not sure, you know, what they're equating to, then you can look and find a list. So you can label your pan if need be.
Yeah, I mean, you could find anything on YouTube. I YouTubed yesterday how to YouTube something, and it was a vicious circle, but I got through it. I also want to encourage everybody, if you have questions, just put them over at the type thing, the chat thing, and we'll do our best to answer those. Jaimie has some licks for us that work great in improv for this song, and I just want to remind you it's in the key of F, and Jaimie, take it away. These are Jaimie's jams.
So when I'm improvising on a song, I typically start super simple. It's not necessary to take improv, and you have to do all these crazy notes and know all these scales. It can be really simple. So the first thing that I noticed when I was playing this tune is, and I only knew the chorus because this tune was on an M&M's commercial when I was younger. So I recognized "Don't Rock the Boat," the M&M's are singing it. So I don't know. That's how I knew it. So I'm looking at the melody part, which is around measure 9 here. Okay, so just those couple measures. And if I'm going to do a little bit of improv, I'm just going to maybe play the note that passes in between those tones. So I might go. I only changed it a little bit, and I only knew how to do that because when I was playing, when I was warming up and playing some of the chords and the scales, I know that, you know, the G is between F and A. So G can take me to A from F. The other thing, so simple changes to the melody to start. The other thing I do when I see a long note, for example, there's a kind of a long note in measure 16, that low D there, if you're looking at the tenor part, I will do a little bit of riffing maybe on the chord that is written in the music on the lead sheet. So from the little the bridge there. Just add like a little bit of a D minor chord. That's all I did was arpeggiate the little D minor chord. Super simple little touches to still make the melody recognizable, but make it your own.
That's great advice. I was thinking the same thing. At the very first part of this song, if you played anything in the F major scale, you're probably going to be okay. Some things sound better than others, but Jaimie and I were talking about the pentatonic scale. Could you explain that for us, the pentatonic scale?
Sure, I think you covered it last week too. So the pentatonic scale has 5 notes in it, and it's scale degrees 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6. So instead of playing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in F like this, I'm gonna skip the 4th scale degree, which is B flat, and play 5 and 6 instead. So F, G, A, C, D. And any version of that, any octave, you can play them up high. Any order, it all sounds beautiful because that chord also is kind of alluding to the blues scale. You can throw an A flat in there if you want. It's a color note you can use.
That's great. And the scale also, you can use just that, like she said, you can start on C and E though. If you go to the pan cam here, I'm starting on C and D and F, G, A. You don't have to start on F, F, G, A, C, D. You could start on the low one, C, D, just as long as you do the same notes. Now, we were playing this earlier, and I noticed that they have a lot of this little riff. They have a lot of that little melody, so I thought, well, that's a great improv tool. I did a repetition so that it sounds recognizable, and people like that. So we're going to run through. I'm just going to do one time through this. But before I do that, I also want to talk to you about the map or the roadmap of this. So before you do anything playing a song, here's the things that usually have to happen. What key is it in? How many sharps and flats? Is it in 4/4? And then you look to see, okay, where do we start? Where do we play to? Where do we go back? Now, when I write my charts out, I try to stay on 2 pages because I don't want to have to be turning pages. So everything is on 2 pages. 3 pages gets kind of dicey. So in major 5, I see a repeat. And so I play down, and I don't have this on here, but on the other page, there's a first ending, which takes you back to major 5. Then you play again, and then you get to page 2, do the second ending, and you're done. And I think that's all there is to this one. So things I'm looking for, repeat signs, those little things with 2 dots next to them, that's a repeat sign. I'm looking for that. I'm also looking for, I'm going to go to the board and write this out, actually. I'm looking for things like, I'm going to actually even erase. I'm looking for repeat signs, those little things. I'm also looking for first and second endings, because that tells me, when I get to the first ending, I see another repeat sign. That's like a telephone line. In the old days, we had to have 2 telephone lines. You go back to the repeat at major 5, and then you play it through again. You come to the first ending, you go, hey, I already played that. I'm going to jump and play the second one this time. So you also want to talk about the style a little bit. What kind of style is it? Well, this is a soca beat. And let's see, is there anything else I want to make sure I cover? Chords, styles. Now, we're not completely interested. If you're just playing the song the very first time, you're not really concerned about chords. You're more concerned about, I'm going to play a right note. Now, when I get, since this song moves so quickly, I don't harmonize every note. There's just no way I can do that. Maybe Jim Taylor can, but I can't. So what I would tell you is that there are notes that I do harmonize. For instance, let's talk about major 18. There's a written D. And there's a G minor chord over G, M. So I'm like, okay, well, I have G, B flat, and D. Well, how do I know what those chords are? You go to your theory sheet, and you find that chord, G minor. You find what notes are involved in that. And you go, oh, there's a G minor, G, B flat, D. Well, what note am I playing for the melody? I'm playing the D. So my only other choices are G and B flat. Well, G and B flat or D and B flat sound really nice. So I'm going to play through a little bit of the song and then we'll do some more talking. And while we're doing that, hey, Jaimie, why don't you tell us about our donations this week are going to go to the Humane Society from her hometown now, which is North Carolina, Charlotte, North Carolina. Can you talk to us about your recent acquisition?
Yes, I have waited 33 years, well, I guess it was 32 years, to have a dog. I've always wanted a dog. And so after the 4th of July happened this past summer, I thought, you know, we were ready. We live in a place where it doesn't really snow anymore. We don't have to worry about being cold. It was just perfect timing. We lived in an apartment. So we went to the Charlotte Humane Society and just was like, kind of just whoever's there, we're going to see if anybody just clicks with us. And a little doggy named Panda, cutest little two-month-old, just like little mixed breed dog. He's so cute. We took him home. We named him Porter, and he has been one of the most just loving, fun, cute, annoying, barky additions to our family. And it's been so nice to have him around, especially not being able to see very many friends and family and kind of just being here. So it's been such a joy. And the Humane Society was so amazing when we went to adopt him, and they gave us everything we needed. They were very patient. They were super nice to the dogs. I could tell that they really love dogs, and I'm so happy that any money that can be given will go to them, because they deserve it. So.
33 years though. Why did you have to wait 33 years to get a dog? That's outrageous. What kind of parents did you have?
Awesome. My parents, man, they just refute. No, you know, it just wasn't the right time. It was just never the right time. And it was the right time now.
So. It's not that I don't like dogs. It's the fact that we were just gone all the time. We were typically playing places and, you know, just heading around to Hutchinson, which is 10 miles away.
to Wichita. So. Yeah. No, and I have a backyard now. So, because we ended up getting a house, and so it's just all perfect. And the puppy stages was in the apartment. So, all the, you know, peeing on the floor and, you know, biting things just happened at the apartment that we didn't own. And now he's all potty trained and loves our yard. So,
well, that's great. I do want to remind people that if you have questions, this is a great time to ask. We are just pretty much playing through. We'll keep an eye out for it. Well, I'm going to run through it one time, just the first half. And scale a little bit, but I also played with just stay upstairs and hear on the tough G, A, C, and D. As you can see, I used the same rhythm that the song was using. I used the same rhythm in the way I improv, because I didn't want to play, I wanted to play in the style, and that's why style is important for the song. You want to play similar things to what's happening. And I did play an F and A together on that one chord. Again, I can't double stop with all of these. I just can't. I could try. Here's the beginning, or the second line. I probably could do that at some level, but it's just a lot of work. So I try to concentrate. When I have a long note, I try to play something with it. For instance, at 12, I did the B-flat, awfully high. I could have done a B-flat and D at 12. I think I did an F and A here. And I did an A-flat and C. But at the melody, didn't really do very much on that. So I just want to play the melody a couple times going on now.
Dad, can I add something?
Go ahead, Amy.
When you're, so oftentimes I'm playing by myself, and maybe that's the case for maybe anybody who's watching, that you're performing or just playing by yourself, maybe with a background track. And I remembered Dad saying one time to me that the harmony, it's more full if you play the lower harmony. So find the lowest version of the note in the chord and play that with that. So instead of maybe playing the F and A that are closest to each other, maybe if you're playing a high F, play that low A with it. So meaning try not to play the harmonies too close together in this, in the range. So if you're playing a high note, find the harmony note that's lower in the range.
Another way to say that might be to say 90% of the time I have the melody note is on top, all the harmonies underneath. Now that's not 100%, but most of the time we want the melody to be on top so we can hear better. So that's mm-hmm. that's really well put up. Where did you learn how to play the pan and everything? That's amazing.
Awesome. Yeah, I just, wow.
Okay. Speaking of gig, and we Jaimie grew up playing with our family band, Tropical Shores Steel Drum Band. And do you have any gig tips for us? Now, not everybody is a gigger right at this point. I mean, we understand that, but someday, you never know, you might be out gigging, and some of these tips may come in handy. So, Jaimie, what's your tropical tip of the day?
Okay, if I had to pick one for somebody who's current, I'll do one for somebody who's currently gigging and who maybe would gig in the future. For somebody who's currently gigging, I started to do this a long time ago. I noticed a guitar player at a coffee shop was taking a break, and then he put on music of his own. So he was controlling kind of what the break sounded like. A lot of places you play may have background music already. If you're playing at a restaurant, they probably have music that was going before you, and they may turn it on, but I always like to be able to control kind of what they're hearing in the break. So always have like a Spotify playlist, or look up a playlist on YouTube, or use, you know, any other music that you want to play during your break, so it's not just dead air and silence. And then for somebody who's not gigging that maybe would like to gig in the future, I would say that you need to get yourself out there. I didn't really start having any success until I literally mailed flyers, I gave out business cards, I played for free at a kite store in Wisconsin. That was my first gig when I moved up to Wisconsin, was at a kite store. Play for free, get your name out there, get on the internet, join the websites that book people, and really just get your name out there. With all these social media platforms, it's so easy to get the word out about what you can provide for people. So those are my two gig tips.
Those are great tips. The one I was talking about, we were talking about in the pre-show, we have a pre-show now. I was talking about take your mallets with you when you go on your break, because people will come up, you know, you're over there probably sitting down trying to relax, and maybe they're feeding you and you're not really paying attention, and all of a sudden you hear somebody smacking your pan with a mallet. I always just put my mallet in my pocket as I walk off, and just an equipment thing. Some a lot of people will come up and they'll want to play their pan, or they'll be holding their 5-year-old and they'll say, "Look, Johnny, you know," and you want them to see that. And if they sometimes I've even given them mallets, so be very gentle, you know, and they're pretty good about that. What you don't want is a kid who's out of control running up and grabbing your mallet and start playing better than you, because then you'll lose the game. Going back to the CD. That's a great one, because you really don't want dead air, but I also don't want to play my own. See, that's what happens. That's why I can't have anything nice. I don't want to play my CD, because that's exactly what I'm playing. And then again, I don't want to play one that's really, really, really good, because I don't sound that good. So it's maybe something else, like some music that's totally different, but maybe still appropriate for that venue. But I thought about that for a long time. I don't want to play one that's like Bob Marley doing One Love, and then I'm going to play it in the next set. Of course, I'm not Bob Marley, so he sounds better than me, and I don't have vocals. So, great ideas there. We have a chat coming in. Andrea, that's a great idea. She says to bring your jumbie pan, which is, I have one here, I can't get to it, but it's a little 12-inch one. It's got probably 8 or 9 notes, and it's in the key of G. You can probably get it for $100. It's great to bring with you, because you can show them. It's accessible to people low to the ground, and that's a great idea. Which I
don't know. And Dad, don't you have some jumbie pan music available?
I do. That's an awesome transition. Where'd you learn all that, Martin? Yes, I have written music for Jumbie Pan. I have a book, 2 books available. One is Jumbie Pan, it's Island Music, and then one other one is Classic Hymns. And all of that music and everything that we're doing is available at tropicalshores.net. And feel free to do that. My sound person, Mischievous, she and I are doing a Jumbie Pan. At some day when we get back to some sort of normal, we do Jumbie Pans for assisted living places to where they can learn to do this, or I'm doing those also with younger kids. So haven't got to do that yet because of the pandemic. That was last year. And so, good advice there, Andrea. Thank you for that. Okay, what else do we have? I want to remind you, next week is going to be a song called Mambo Italiano. They talk about mozzarella in there. I don't know what all they're saying, but it's all I heard. You had that mozzarella. So I have, Mischievous has my pan here for me. If you don't know what the jumbie pan is, this is the jumbie pan. And that's probably, 15 inches around. There's it's a G scale. And it's a challenge, I gotta tell you, it's a challenge to play, because if you play the lead, it's not the same pattern. And it's only to write for, it's challenging, because you can only write songs that are in the G scale. And I mean the G scale. And I've had to alter. I could play Yellow Bird on here, but I had to alter it a little bit to fit that. But anyway, those are available. I think Panyard has those. They're probably $150 for the whole thing. It comes with a stand and mallet and everything. Pretty cool. Yeah, next week is Mambo Italiano, and I'll have that as soon as I can on Bradshaw's Music, and you go to the steel drum page or steel drum tab. I'm putting the lead sheet and the harmony sheet, if you're on, then the theory sheet, and whatever else I can think of. I'm starting to throw all kinds of stuff in there. All right. I like to play just some of the gig backing tracks by themselves during break. Yeah. Keeps the feeling, but not more of the same. Yeah. I agree. Just the backing track, not with the melody. That's what I understand. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Good idea.
That was a good idea.
I'd probably be sitting there listening going, oh, I should play that song. Sometimes I don't play that song.
Like, oh, that good, that one will be next.
Jaimie, can you tell us, what is one of your favorite songs to play? Do you have a favorite?
Oh my gosh. Lately, it's How Deep Is Your Love, which I'm only in my 30s, so I'm not a super Bee Gees fan, but I really, when we played it at your workshop in two summers ago, oh my gosh, who knows what even year it is, I did not know that tune, and I really like it, and it turns out a lot more people know it than I thought, and I really love that when I play songs that people, when I play songs that people know, like the other time I played, and I also love, oh no, it's escaping me, it's the Spyro Gyro tune, Morning Dance, thank you, I love that one too, I don't know why, it's just fun and happy, and somebody came up with a Spyro Gyro, and I was like, yes, so it's fun just to play ones that people know, but yeah, the ones that people don't know, I like, did you write Dreadlock Holiday, or is that already
into? That's a song.
I like that one. And what's one that you wrote that I really like?
All My Wonderful Music. I will say that, I think How Deep Is Your Love came out about 1977. I was in high school, probably a senior high school, and who knew? Can't Help Falling in Love is another one. Who knew you could play Elvis on the steel drum? I mean, it's just, the steel drum is such a, you can play anything. You can play Ida Klein and Knock music.
Star Wars.
Is that the Death Star?
Yeah, one of my students told me to learn it. When I first met my new students here in Charlotte, they requested that one, so I added that to my look what I can do repertoire.
Yeah. Well, Jaimie, you have
Cinco de Samba. Did you write that one?
Cinco Samba.
Cinco Samba.
I did write Cinco Samba.
And the other one, Cinco Samba, and there's another cool one that you did that's kind of that same style. Anyway.
We have some people on here that I know. Annette Nichol is on here. She lives in Florida. Lives in Colorado. Thank you for joining us. And Kathy, of course, is here. And Andrea is here. Thank you very much. Not Very Tired is also a good one, Andrea. You're right.
Yes.
Who knew? You know, that these songs would be, they're just fun to play and they're fun to listen to. And those are all from my youth was one of those. Let's see. So I want to encourage everybody to join us next week. We're going to be on same time, 5 o'clock Central Time. I know the Chiefs are playing right now, so we're in Kansas City. Or we're in Kansas, so I know we have a vested interest in that. But I'm checking my list here.
Patrick Mahomes had turf toe. That's his, because we were wondering, because he hit his head kind of last week, but it wasn't a concussion. He just got momentarily knocked out or something. But the other thing he has is turf toe. I didn't even know that was a thing. Yeah, I thought that just meant he had a bunch of turf nuggets in his shoes, but it's apparently you sprained one of your toes some way bad or something, and it takes forever to heal, so.
That's right. I also want to tell you that Mambo Italiano, Rosemary Clooney sang that. She was famous for singing that, if you know who that is. I do. I don't quite remember how I know her. All right, so I want to, there was one thing, before we do the play-along, there was one thing I wanted to tell you, is another great improv thing is to just do chord tones, and especially on this song, starting at major 15, you have an F major, and I did a B minor after that, back F major. G minor. Yes, I'm playing that in a rhythmic, kind of a syncopated version, but I am playing the chord tones, and if people aren't really listening, they'll go, wow, that person really knows how to improv, and you're going, well, I'm just outlining the chords here now, but thank you. Tip, please. I do remember, Dave, you remember when we were on our cruise a few years ago, we weren't playing anything, but we got off the boat there in the Bahamas, and the tourists are walking in, and there's a small steel drum band, and they were doing this. They were taking turns doing this. Just with two or three notes. And people were walking by and going, wow, look at the steel drums. And, but, Jaimie and I and my family were going, That's not that. So do you remember seeing that?
Yeah, and we asked to go. It seems like this is the theme, and I tell this story all the time about the one that was in town, the boy that was in town when we asked to go to play, and we pretended that we were just tourists, but we pretended we had never seen a steel drum before, and we go up and say, "Oh my gosh, wow, do you mind, like, can I try it?" And so we pretend, of course, and then we bust out like, and then and their face was like,
"Actually, can I just tell the real story? You might not."
Okay.
That was yes, a nice summary, but this is actually what happened. We have pictures to prove it. We're walking along. We were doing a treasure hunt or a scavenger hunt. Jake mm-hmm. and I were on the same team, and we heard somebody playing steel drums. And so, you know, we're in the motherland, so we go and we find this guy, and he's probably 18 or 19. And so we're watching him, and he's watching me watch him, and he's going kind of like, "You want to come over?" And I'm like, No, it's okay, I'm good. And Jamie's like, "Yeah, it's right, you're good, you're not going over there." And pretty soon he's like, now he's motioning to me, I'm like, okay. So I walk over, and he says, "Well, this is a steel drum," and I said, "Yeah, I've seen those before. I have one at home." He probably thinks I'm talking about a drum pan. He has no idea I have like 15 drums. And so he's playing along, he did a scale, and he goes, "Well, this is the scale," and he did a... So he said, "Here, you want to try it?" And I'm like, "Oh, you know, this is your instrument. I don't want to do that. You know, I'm just happy to see you." And so I said, "Okay." So he kept goading me on. I did that. He goes, "Wow, you're really you're quick." I said, "Well, I'm really good at seeing, say, kind of things like mother man,
speak and spell." I don't.
So then I said, "Well, I have one at home." And he goes, "Oh, really?" I said, "Yeah, I know this song. He probably thinks it's gonna be." I had to bust out. And the look on his face was precious. Because first off, he didn't know that song, which I think is kind of the national anthem of steel drums. Under the Sea, everybody has to play that. So anyway, it was a fun time, and I embarrassed a lot of people. So,
myself included, not sure.
I see that the Buccaneers won, and Tom Brady have the floor is Buccaneers. So she's saying Buccaneers and Bills would be nice, right? I mean, it would be better would be the Buccaneers and the Chiefs would be nice, but I'm happy for him because he's like
the Packers and the Chiefs, okay. Of course, but
he's 40. He's at least 40 something, 43.
Yeah,
but he's
old
he's
man.
In good shape. There was a guy named George Bland who played for the Oakland Raiders back in the old days. He was 46, and not only could he punt and pass the football, he could punt and kick field goals and everything, and he was 46 and he smoked heavily. I mean, he looked like he had a rough life, but he was, at that time, I was probably in my early teens, and I thought, 46? What's he doing on the field? And probably right, but anyway, George Bland. Hey, there's Jackie, good to see you. Okay.
Hi, Jackie.
I wanted to also let you know that these also replay. These are live now, but they'll replay later on this channel. So if you follow the channel, you'll see that. I always did an introduction a couple days before to remind you, hey, we're going to do this song. And I always wanted to remind people to go to bradshoresmusic.com and download the music. And while you're there,
my doggy wants to say hi. He says, "Thank you, everybody. If you donate, my brothers and sisters will get help."
Old Porter.
Puppy. He's 9 months old now. All right, sorry.
Well, he's doing more than you do when you were 9 months, that's for sure.
Okay.
So, anyway, we appreciate the donations. We're trying to upgrade our situation with our equipment, but we also donated. Last week, we donated to the Hospice House of Reno County, which is in Kansas. And before that, it was the Children's Home in Wichita. So, we're just looking for the places to donate and appreciate all your help. So, and as a finale to this time, we're going to play through the entire thing. Now, I'm going to play through it for the first time. I'm going to play through it, pretty much stay with it. I'm going to stay with the melody. The second time, I'm going to just do some improv, and I might even say what I'm doing. So, Jamie, don't interrupt me, because I'll be in the zone at that point. And I think I don't have page 2 up on your screen, but just page 1. But if you download it, then you know. All right, here we go. Jaimie, I realized that A flat is really nice when you play the C, D, F, G, A flat. Love that.
It's juicy.
Mm-hmm. And I like the way, if you use repetition, I like it. Was, you said to use the pentatonic scale, so I started using the pentatonic scale. So we have repetition and we have the, and the scale. So when you play it like that, it, it really sounds great. And I can tell you this, when you, the best way I can describe repetition is, again, I probably said this 100 times, I've said this to you probably, Jaimie, is when you play a lick and the chords change behind you, it's like having your senior picture taken. You're wearing the same thing, but the background. Now you're on a glacier, and then you're on a beach. You're the same person wearing the same thing, but it makes you look differently. So, yeah. All right. Well, I'm being told by Mischievous that we're going long here. Steel Magic. I like that name, Andrea. That's a really good name. I might even use that someday. Well, okay, I think we're, Jaimie, do you have anything to add to this? We thank you for everybody for checking in on us. It's good to have you.
I was just going
to
say thank you, Dad. Thank you, Dad, for having me, and I really enjoy, my whole career is teaching and being with students and making music, and it's been hard to not be able to do that. And so, but the silver lining is finding out that we can do things like this to connect, even though, you know, we can't be together. It's really great to, you know, be with you and play with you and talk shop with you and everybody else. So
it is fun. It's a blessing. We just enjoy it. So I would say that also, I haven't been out with my students a lot because of the pandemic, but you know, the time we spent together is really fun. And our steel drum band practices kind of on their own anyway. So they can't all be there at the same time, so we do a lot of kind of lesson-y sort of things that we play together at some point. So mm-hmm. We want to thank everybody for dropping by and spread the word. We'd like to have more people around, and we will see you next Sunday at 5 Central Time. Now, when the Super Bowl comes around, I don't know what will happen. We'll have to maybe do a tape delay or something. I don't know. But Jaimie, would you be willing to come back next week if you're available?
Yeah, if the Chiefs aren't, no. Yes, I'll be here.
Well, the Chiefs wouldn't play next week anyway, so.
Oh, that's right.
Super Bowl's 2 weeks. Anyway, that's for later.
Right.
Thanks again. We'll see you
Let's
next time.
Let's do it.
Bye, Jaimie.
Bye, everybody.